kids sitting face to face. They are looking at their smartphones. Their faces are illuminated with the light of the screen. Their eyes are seriously looking at one point, while their fingertips are moving on the screen up and down. You wonder, what's wrong with them? You continue with, when I was a child, I was not like you. You start telling your childhood stories, how you were playing with your friends, running around, getting dirty, having fun. You receive a notification in your newest model of smartphone. Your latest post got many likes, and there, the same pale light starts illuminating your face while you're scrolling the screen up and down with your fingers. In the background, we see that the children are still playing with their smartphones. If we look at them carefully, we can see exactly what they are doing. They speak to each other from time to time, saying, "Take it, run after me, shoot it." Yes, they are playing the same game, but in a virtual environment, even together with their other friends who are not with them physically at the moment. The screen becomes a place where they can connect and play. Indeed, I'm talking about the digital natives, a term coined by Prensky in 2001. The digital natives are the ones who can speak the technology's language. They are born in a territory, in a world, in which the digital has already become an integral part of physical. They live in this hybrid world and are often mediated through screen-based digital devices. Even before they open their eyes to the physical world, their parents share their very first picture on social media. They meet their grandparents for the first time through a window of a hand-sized device. The screen becomes a fundamental everyday life object. Everything, such as communicating, learning, playing, happens within the limited surface of the screen, in a black box that they do not even know how it functions. As a designer, I have been always curious. Curious to open those black boxes, to see what's inside. Bring the inside out, shape it, play with it, extend its limits. The limits that lay between physical and digital. When I was 8 years old, I had my first computer, Commodore 64. You may recall the blue screen and the pixels if you had one as well. My computer was attached to a small TV screen, and for hours and hours, I was trying to write codes that were a kind of an unknown language to me that time. All this effort was to make the red balloon to fly from one corner to the other. Although I thought I would have achieved a great satisfaction of my own creation, on the contrary, I was very frustrated that the balloon was somehow trapped inside the screen. And there, I started wondering, what if I could make the red balloon fly out of my screen? Could I really make it happen? Although many developments in technology have happened since my first Commodore 64, the same question is still ringing. Can we interact with the digital technologies or with the digital world beyond the boundaries of the screen? Can we grasp it or blend it into our physical environments? I try to answer those questions together with children, the so-called digital natives. I'm not a designer who would offer them solutions from top down, but I design together with them, we co-create alternative futures for human-technology interaction. In co-design workshop, we first try to open those black boxes to take the pieces out, the actuators and sensors, reorganize them on our bodies, in our artifacts, place them on our spaces, while imagining the future scenarios for human-technology interaction. Now, I will bring you to one of those alternative worlds. The ideas in this world, which we will see right now, were co-created by children, the young digital natives, who were participating to some of the co-design workshops that I, together with another colleague, Roberta Bonetti, conducted and facilitated. Let's enter to this imaginary world. We are in the city center. Walking through the streets, we arrive to a square in which there is a big, giant sphere with the light fading in and out. There are people around it. Some of them are touching it. Some of them are listening to what it whispers. It's not a magic sphere which tells the secrets of the universe. It recalls the previously lived emotions. It's kind of a big archive of collective sentiments of the citizens. We continue our journey. There is a man walking and looking at an object on his wrist. Guess what he's looking at? The time? Or how many emails that he has received? Or how many steps that he has made? None of them. He's checking how many times that he has touched someone else or has been touched. The object tells how connected he is, not virtually, but physically. We see two people in different corners of the square, both wearing glasses. You probably wonder if they are wearing virtual reality glasses immersed in a virtual world. Actually, not. They are seeing the world from the other person's perspective. They exchange their visions and experiences in order to have more empathy towards each other. There's another person. She's wearing an object on her body. When she touches this object, she feels the warmth depending on how the object is treated. The temperature tells if the object is sad, depressed, or happy. It needs the care and attention of its user rather than making its user happy. Have you ever imagined making a device or object happy? We see another person. She's running after a rolling object. The object brings her to unknown destinations, makes her meet new people on the way, and discover new places. As now, it stops in front of a house, and we enter this house to discover more. There's a fridge, which looks like a normal fridge. When we open it, we see that some items are disappearing. The fridge recognizes if the food is more than the family needs and transmits the extra food to other families who are in need. It's not simply ordering a new bottle of milk because the one in the fridge is terminating. On the contrary, it distributes the food equally between other fridges in the world. It's like an Internet of Things that can make moral decisions rather than making us consume more. So, our journey ends here for now. But we see that when we give the power to children, they come up with a world which is very similar, but at the same time, quite different than what we offer them today. By entering into their world, we see that for them, technology is not something like a device that fulfills our needs, or a servant that makes us entertain, or a caregiver that makes us healthier. It's something that coexists with us. It's not captive or trapped inside a screen. It's on our bodies, in our beloved objects, in our cities, in a world in which we can still see, feel, and touch each other. There is one more room that we haven't visited yet, but this room is in between the imaginary and real. There are two kids playing with their smartphones. All of a sudden, a pop-up message arrives and invites them to play with a soft toy. They bring the soft toy closer to the screen, and there, a smartphone app suggests them to play a fun game together. The task is to walk on this toy, following the vibrations, while trying to stay in balance. This is Warmy, an interactive soft toy, a bridge between the screen and physical play. It's a result of a design project that I, together with other two colleagues, Christy Kusk and Michele Honer, developed together to expand the play experience from the flat surface of the screen to the physical world, while reconnecting kids with their own bodies and with their friends. And now, I hold the prototype of Warmy. As once I was wondering to make a red balloon fly out of my screen, today, with this and many other projects, I have been trying to turn the pixels, ones and zeros, the language of digital technology, into something that we can experience with our whole body, something we can touch, feel, and share, something that is not trapped inside the frame of a screen, but is open, free to be shaped and reshaped. Now, I would like to invite everyone to think about all your ideas, projects that are waiting to see the light, to be liberated and freed. How many imaginary worlds, alternatives, possibilities are confined inside the frame that we hold in our minds? What's your red balloon? Let your imagination free it. Thank you.